For about a year now, I've been using this workbench right here. It was only ever meant to be a temporary design, and frankly, it sucks. It's not fit for purpose at all. So today, I'm gonna try and make a better, more suited to purpose workbench, and I'm gonna try and keep it as cheap as possible. So make sure you stick around to the end of the video, because not only am I gonna show you how I build it and the mistakes that come with that, but I'm gonna tell you exactly how much it costs. Let's go. So before I can design what workbench I do want, I need to work out what's wrong with the old one. And let's start with this. It's got an 18mm plywood top, but it has absolutely no support underneath. And when you're working at this with hand tools mostly, like I do, it's just not sturdy enough or strong enough to take the constant repeated blows with a mallet, a chisel, a hammer, or sawing, or whatever it may be. When I first put this together, I put the whole thing onto casters or wheels because I thought it'd be great for moving it around the workshop. But actually, my workshop's a tiny space and the bench never moves. But by putting it on these wheels and not having them out to the side where they can pop up and down like some I've seen, it means that the bench actually is really unsteady and constantly wobbles when I'm trying to do any heavy work with a plane or a saw. Not ideal. The vise is poorly installed and the metal at the top is actually flush with the surface of the workbench, which means that the jaws need to be higher. So if I want to flatten anything to what I know is a flat surface, I can't do that because all the work pieces are protruding above my workbench too high. And on top of that, because the jaws are sat so high, they're not attached properly, and any upwards pressure on the top just pops off the screws I used to put them in. Again, not ideal when you're trying to saw something or do some precision chisel work. And finally, the bench is too low. So when I want to saw something, I end up bent over quite a lot, and actually, it just hurts my back and it's inefficient. And then when you combine that with the fact the bench wobbles, sawing is hard work and it's never as accurate as it could be, even with my limited skill set. However, what I will say is this bench allowed me to get into woodworking and get started and made me fall in love with the hobby as a whole. So it's not all bad. It's just time to make something a bit more reliable, a bit more sturdy, that's going to allow me to create the bigger projects I eventually want to move on to in the future.
With all that being said and done, let's get on with the build. So I ordered a load of construction 2x4s, and although I didn't draw up any plans for this project, which was a mistake I'll come on to later, I knew I wanted the top to be made of laminated 2x4s and to be attached to the legs by mortise and tenon joints. So after the delivery, I spent a bit of time arranging the worktop piece and then clamped it together so I could draw a line and proceed to cut it to rough length. 2x4s come with a rounded edge, which is no good for the glue up and would make flattening the slab a lot harder later on. So I also knew I'd need to remove that during this part of the process as well.
As someone who works almost exclusively with hand tools, the temptation to use my hand plane and just slowly but surely work the rounded edges off these is almost too tempting. But with the serious amount of lumber I've got, I think this would take me far too long and just be impractical. So I'm going to have to find a better solution.
The 2x4 fit perfectly into a notch on my sawhorses, which held it securely and allowed me to break out the electric hand planer. It's an extremely cheap tool, and I don't like using it. I find it very intimidating, but it made quick work of the rounded corners on the 2x4s, although I did find myself wishing more than I ever have for a table saw or thickness planer, as they would have made these cuts a lot more repeatable, and therefore made flattening the slab much, much easier later on. After a fair bit of time planing, I was left with a large amount of sawdust on my patio that I then had to sweep up. But more importantly, all of the 2x4s had now had their rounded edges removed, which would hopefully give me a flatter and better surface when it came to gluing up the legs and slab top itself. I then brought them inside and separated them into their piles I'd be gluing them up in. I chose to do them in four chunks because I haven't got a huge amount of clamps and I wanted to make sure that I got the best fit and joint possible, and then thought once I'd glued up the four separate parts, I could then glue them together and make a giant slab top. It was at this time I found the knot you can see on the screen now. I didn't have any epoxy or anything, so I stabilized it with super glue. I've no idea if this is the right way to do things, so please let me know in the comments below if I'm wrong, but it seems to be holding up for me so far. The last thing I had to do before I could start the glue up of the worktop bench was to create the four mortises where the leg tenons would eventually sit to join sort of the whole bench together. And I've never really cut these before, so I figured the best way to do it was to cut a half lap in a 2x4 and then sandwich that between two sort of whole 2x4s. And when glued up, that would create a perfect mortise for the leg tenon to slide into. I cut the mortises that would be facing each other on the short side of the bench together because I figured this would make it easier to align them using a square during the glue up, and mean that eventually when I connected the two legs with braces and rails, they would align perfectly and there'd be no twist to the bench. I measured directly off of each piece of wood and labelled it with what leg it was going to be a part of, because this meant that if I had taken too much of a pass with the planer at any one point, I wasn't working off of one set of measurements for the legs. I was working off of the exact leg that would fit into the exact mortise at that time. Cutting out the half laps that eventually became the mortises was fairly simple. I started off by making a series of straight cuts with a tenon saw. Then I popped out the majority of the waste using a chisel and a mallet. Then finally, I used a sharp chisel with a flat back to flatten the inside or the base of where the mortise would eventually be. With all that done, I placed each half lap between two 2x4s to create the mortise for the eventual tenon of the legs. I then covered these with painter's tape to try and prevent too much excess glue from spilling into the mortise during the creation of the slab top. And I also packed out my sash clamps with parcel tape to try and prevent excess glue squeezing out and blocking the clamps from working throughout future glue ups. Big projects mean lots of glue. So I looked around to try and find the largest bottle of Titebond I could, and was shocked to discover you can actually get it in a gallon, which is an insane amount of glue, but I will post a link to that in the description in case anyone needs to order some themselves. And actually, it worked out cheaper than buying lots of little bottles, so in the long run, it's more beneficial. It was finally time to glue the worktop together. So I did some gluing, and then some clamping, and then some gluing, and then some clamping, and then some gluing. You get the picture. It took ages. I experimented with different ways to spread the glue out during this and started off just using my hand, which was a terrible idea. So switched to a foam roller, which was really good for spreading the glue across sort of the long surfaces of the 2x4s. But I did definitely use too much glue, and you can see a lot of squeeze out here. And if I ever do another big build like this, I'll make sure to use a more suitable amount, because it was just wasteful in the end. Once all the glue had finally dried, it was time to take the clamps off, flip it over, and start flattening the top. Unfortunately, I don't have access to a planer thicknesser or a drum sander or even a belt sander. So it was time to whack out the trusty number 5 hand plane and start planing. And planing. And planing. And planing.
Okay, so I'm about an hour into flattening the tabletop and it's starting to resemble a slab top. Leaving so much glue though was a real mistake and has actually taken me significantly more effort to remove the excess. So if any of you are doing something similar, or if I was ever to build a bench again, I think something I'd definitely do is make sure you take off the excess when it's tacky, not before it's dried. I'm amassing a pretty serious amount of shavings. So I think I'm gonna call it there for the day, come back, hit it again tomorrow. Cool, see you there. Flattening this is quite the workout. Now, if you're still watching, I'd really appreciate it if you could click that like button for me. It helps spread my videos to other people. And if you're enjoying watching me suffer, or if you feel like you're learning something, or just enjoying the build in general, please subscribe and click that bell notification. Every subscriber is so important to me, and I love having you all along for the journey. I guess in video mode, this won't take that long, but real life doesn't work like that. So I better get back to it. See you in a bit.
After a lot more hand planing and a brew break, because I was feeling sorry for myself, the bench was flat enough that I could get out two straight edges to check for high spots and just work on specific areas that needed doing. And then not too long after that, the bench was flat enough that it was time to flip it over and start working on where the legs were going to go.
Okay, so there is significantly more excess glue on the underside and it would be a waste to try and get rid of it and to flatten the bottom because nobody's ever going to see it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to flatten where the legs are going to go. So I've got a good reference surface for the mortise and tenons and I'm going to flatten where I'm going to put the vices on here as well. But apart from that, I'm going to leave the rest alone. So hopefully this should be a quicker job. Before I flatten anything, I'm going to take a chisel and I'm just going to take the edges off the outside of these mortises to avoid tearing them out and ripping them everywhere. So let's do that now.
Flattening the underside of the bench really didn't take long at all. And before I knew it, I was checking it over with a straight edge and then I was ready to move on to fitting the legs.
So, now that the bench is flat enough, we're going to start taking a look at how we're going to do the legs. And the idea is, I'm going to take one 2x4 and it'll eventually form the tenon part of the leg and slot into this mortise here. But as it stands, the 2x4 is slightly too long. This is actually a deliberate mistake. Frank's Workbench put out an amazing video that I'm going to link to in the description below that suggests if you leave the tenon too long, you can plane it down so you get a perfect snug fit into the mortise. That's the idea anyway. We're gonna give it a go. Okay, moment of truth, here we go.
I then repeated this process for the other three tenons that would form the remainder of the legs in the end. And once these were all fitted, it was time to measure up for where the stretchers were going to go. The idea behind the stretcher was the exact same as how I'd created the mortises for the legs. So I just clamped a 2x4 onto the legs, which were now dry fit, marked up where they were going to go, and then repeated the same process and created a half lap in the legs, which would eventually form the mortise for where the tenon of the stretcher would go. With the half laps now cut, I used the same trick as before to turn them into mortise and tenons for the leg joints, and then glued the legs up together. Yes, the foam roller came out again for this because I realized it is the most effective way to spread the glue. Once that was all dried, I gave it a quick test fit into its mortises, and once satisfied that they all fit really well, I cleaned them up using a hand plane. I dry fit the legs and then marked out where I wanted the dovetailed half lap braces to go before proceeding to cut those out of some offcuts of 2x4.
Okay, so now that I've cut my dovetails for the braces, I'm gonna use two scraps of 2x4 as spacers to make sure that these are the exact same height on both sides of the bench. This should hopefully mean I get a symmetrical look on both sides of the workbench, but we'll see. My plan now is to cut mortises for these and recess them in. I've done the same as I did with the leg mortise and tenons, and I've left it slightly fat so that I can then plane down across the top of this to ensure a really snug fit. I'm a little worried about wood movement. I'm not an expert in it at all. I don't really understand it, but I know that because these are going across and the laminated 2x4s that are making the top of the workbench going another way, wood movement could be an issue. So I'm not going to glue these in. I'm just going to snugly fit them, then secure them with a screw or some sort of fastener. Let me know in the comments down below if I'm mental and that makes no difference, but that's what I think I'm going to do, and we'll see how it works out.
I cut the recess for the dovetails the exact same way I cut the half laps with mortise and tenons. A little bit of sawing, followed by chopping out the majority of the waste, and then paring away with a chisel to flatten it at the end.
Okay, moment of truth, here we go. Okay, huge stress off my mind. Let's get these screwed in.
All braces and stretchers cut and fitted, it was time to cut the workbench to its final length. And of course, some sanding.
Okay, I think we're just about ready to glue the main assembly of the bench together. Hopefully all the measurements I've made and adjustments are going to work. This won't be the completed project. If it does work, I'll still need to attach some more 2x4s to beef up the stretchers, drill my dog holes and attach my vise. But if this goes well, this should be about to look like a bench. So fingers crossed. Together a little bit. So I need to add another 2x4 onto these, which will form a shelf, a cosmetic shelf here, to provide a bit more support. However, here's to all fit together, which is pretty nice. Okay, leave that to dry overnight. Then come back in tomorrow. Okay, hopefully you can hear me over the rain on the conservatory roof. But now that everything's glued up and dried, I've done my final sanding and my planing. I've realised it's going to be easier to apply the vise to the bench top with the bench flipped upside down. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to apply some finish now to the underframe of the bench, and then I can mount the vise, flip it over, and finish on the top.
Sadly, the lighting was too poor to film finishing the legs, but the next morning I installed the 10-inch vise, which was super simple. I'm going to link the vise and all other tools and equipment I've used in this build down below. And if you do end up clicking and making a purchase, I will make a small commission, which I'll be very grateful for, but it comes at no extra cost to you and helps support me in this woodworking channel. So thank you. Vise installed, I flipped the bench over and was ready to apply finish. Once all the finish was dry, I was able to screw in the thread for the vise, and just like that, the workbench was just about
finished. So the workbench stands at a much better height, so I'm not going to hurt my back when I'm sawing anymore. I'll be able to hand plane more effectively as it has no real wobble, which is fantastic. It's not completely finished. I still need to plane the vise jaw flush. I made a sapele jaw for my 10-inch single thread vise and an oak handle, but let me tell you, making that without a lathe was no joke. It's got half lap dovetails as these sort of rails or braces at the sides, and then mortise, blind mortise and tenons for the stretchers. I haven't leveled the feet yet, but that's because I work on an extremely uneven work surface within the conservatory I'm currently using, and I'm hoping this year to move to a better location. So I didn't want to level the feet for here and waste material when I can level it in my future workshop, fingers crossed. So I've just balanced it with shims for now. Now onto the real question. How much did this cost me, and did I keep it within £100? And the honest answer is no. But I think that's because I didn't plan it. By making this without plans, I ended up with a lot of waste, and I'll bring that waste up on screen now so you can see just how much there is. And if I'd planned better, I could have resourced the cut list I needed to make better and wouldn't have ended up with quite so much wastage of material. I ended up spending about £120 as opposed to the £100 I wanted to. 4x2s averaged out at about £5 each in the end. I honestly think though, if I'd taken more time to plan and come up with a better and more definitive cut list, I could have kept that cost down, or at least just over 100, maybe 105, 110 pounds. But thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoy the video. What would you have done differently? Let me know in the comments below. I do hope you enjoyed the video, and I'm really looking forward to getting some new projects done on it this year. Let me know what you think, and if you would have done anything differently in the build, and if not, I'll see you in the next one. Thank you.